Want to be thankful tonight for the good song service we've had throughout this gospel meeting. I appreciate Ross and Doyle Jean and the songs they have led, and a wonderful job, and that always helps in a gospel meeting. The title of our lesson tonight is Biblical Principles of Success. Success is something that we're all interested in life. I believe everybody wants to be a success, and the Bible will help us to do that, both in our physical walk of life, but more importantly, in our spiritual walk of life. The Bible is the greatest success manual that has ever been written. And every success manual ever written by man has taken its principles right out of this book. Now, they may not always know that's where they got them from, but if there is a good success principle, it's in the Word of God. And that's where we'll find the great success principles for everything that we want to do in life. And so I want to share with you tonight some biblical principles of success. In fact, we'll be looking at five of them tonight. And I believe if we follow these biblical principles of success, we can be a success in this life, and we can certainly gain eternal life and live with the Lord in the world to come. Biblical principle number one that I want to mention tonight would be to set for yourself a goal of excellence. Set for yourself a goal of excellence. It has been determined that 95 out of every 100 Americans have no real goal set in their lives. They just kind of go through life one day after another, and many people go through life with their minds in neutral, just going wherever they're pushed. And that's not really what God intended for us to do. Someone has said that following the path of least resistance is what makes men and rivers crooked. We don't want to just take the path of least resistance. We want to set a goal, and then we want to go out and obtain that goal. If you don't have any real goals in life, guess what? You'll never attain them. We have to determine, first of all in life, here's what I want to do, or here's where I want to go. We find Paul, and if you want to turn with me to Philippians chapter 3, and we'll let this kind of serve as the text of our lesson tonight, Philippians 3 and verse 13. And the biblical principle Paul is mentioning here of setting for yourself a worthy goal. So goal setting is something that the Bible teaches and something that we want to do. In verse 13, he says, "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, reaching forth unto those things which are before." And he talks about leaving behind those other things. And Paul mentions here that he's going to press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Paul had a determination in his heart. This one thing I do. Paul was a goal setter. Paul determined that he was going to go to heaven, he was going to live with God eternally, and he was going to set the goal to do that. Now, Paul did not major in a whole bunch of minors. He didn't have too many fingers and too many pies, or too many irons and too many fires. This one thing I do. Sometimes we get caught up in life and we spread ourselves so thin that we're doing this or we're doing this, and we try to do more things than we can really accomplish, and that doesn't mean that we can't do more than one thing at a time. But Paul said, this one thing I do. Paul had a singleness of mind when it came to Christianity, when it came to his goal of going to heaven, and he said, whether I do anything else or not, this one thing I do, I'm going to press toward the goal. I'm going to obtain eternal life. Paul worked all of his life toward that goal, and that's why he was able to say in 2 Timothy 4 and 6, "For I'm now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I've fought a good fight, I've finished my course, I've kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me in that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing." Paul said, I'm going to heaven. I've made that my goal. I've done that in my life, and you can go too if you'll make it your goal and make it the most important thing that is in your life. I want to give you now some real-life examples of real people of setting for yourself a goal of excellence. The first person that I want to mention is a man I'm sure you've probably never heard of. I assume he's still living, to the best of my knowledge anyway, he is. His name, Lexan Kayar. Lexan Kayar lived in the bush country of Kenya in Africa, and he had a determination to do something with his life. When Lexan was 15 years old, a Presbyterian minister, a missionary, came to the area of Africa that they lived in, and he was there, and he started talking about America and things that were there. And he and his mother listened to this man as he talked about them. Lexan heard about America. He heard that in America you could go to college, you could do this, or you could do that in America. And so at age 15, Lexan decided that he would set for himself a goal of going to college someday in America. Now, Lexan was illiterate. He could not read, he could not write, he didn't know really anything other than what he had learned from this missionary, but he set for himself a goal of excellence. Someday I'm going to go to college in America. I'm not sure he even fully understood what that was at the time, but he had a goal. One day he came to his mother and he said, "Mother, would it be all right if I go to college in America?" Well, she didn't know anything about geography. She had heard there might be another little village on the other side of the next hill, but she didn't know for sure. Maybe that was America. She said, "Well, when do you want to go?" He said, "Well, I'd like to go today." He thought he better go before she figured out where America really was. So she packed him a lunch. She went in and took and boiled some sorghum and some grain and put it together, and took a banana leaf and wrapped it up in that. That was his lunch pail. And so with his machete in his hand and his little lunch box, he took off for America. Now, he had a pretty long journey to go. To begin with, he was 9,000 miles from the shore of our country, so he had a long journey in and of itself in that. For the next 2 years, Lexan walked 2,700 miles until he came to Khartoum, the capital of Sudan. And here he went down to get a boat and decided he would go to America. Well, he got there and he found out it cost money to get passage on a boat to go to America. And of course, he didn't have any money. So the only thing he could do was get a job. So he went and got a job washing dishes. And he figured while he was making some money to earn passage, he started night school. In that time, he learned how to read and he learned how to write. And so now he goes back down and he's ready to leave the country. But now he finds out that it takes a passport, and he doesn't have a passport, so he goes to the embassy, to the consulate, to try and see about getting a passport to America. And there, one of the people at the consulate gave him a catalog that showed all the colleges in America. Well, now he could pick out any college that he wanted to go to in America. Now, for some reason, I have no idea how he made his choice, he decided to go to Skagit Valley College in the state of Washington. And so he wrote a letter there to the president, and he said, I'm going to attend your college. And he said, "I'm working on it. I'm having a little difficulty right now." But he said, "I'd like for you to hold a room for me and a place for me to stay." And that president went out to the student body and told about this young man in Africa. And the student body got together and raised $1,700 sent to him. And he got on a boat and came to America. And in 1964, when a man that I know that preaches the gospel was visiting there in a gospel meeting, Lexan Kayar was going to Skagit Valley College. He finished college, he went back to his home in Africa, and he's still living there and presenting the gospel to people. He obeyed the gospel and is presenting it to people that are there. It shows us that when we set a goal, we can do whatever we want to do. If you want to get an education in America, if Lexan Kayar could do that, you could do that. But you have to set a goal. Had he never set a goal, he would have never obtained what he obtained in life. Let me give you another example of a man, not too far from here, really. Glenn Cunningham was his name. He was from Kansas. Glenn Cunningham and his brother Floyd used to run races on their Kansas farm years gone by. They grew up running everywhere they would go, and Glenn Cunningham set for himself a goal of excellence as a young man, a young teenager. He said, "Someday I'm going to break the world record in the mile run." Now, Glenn didn't know, like any of us do not know, what tomorrow may bring. One cold morning in Kansas, he and his brother Floyd went down to the one-room schoolhouse. It was their job, being a little older, to start the fire and get things warmed up for the other kids and the teacher to come to school. And that morning, they took and put some wood in the old potbelly stove, and they poured some kerosene in. Well, when they went to ignite it, somehow, for some reason, it exploded and blew back fire on them and burned both of them, and caught the school building on fire, and it was smoke everywhere. Glenn did manage to get his brother Floyd and pull him to the door of the school building before he was overcome by the smoke. And finally, those in the community saw the smoke, got to the building, pulled Glenn and his brother out. His brother was already dead. Glenn was burned severely from the waist down. They found a doctor in another town to take him to. The doctor said he'll never live. He'll never make it through the night. Well, Glenn did make it through the night. And after about 3 days, the doctor said, "Well, it does look like he's going to live, but he said he'll never walk again. He'll be an invalid all of his life." Well, he was wrong about that. Glenn was going to make an effort. Remember, he had set a goal for himself. At age 18, his father would take Glenn out when he'd go out of a morning to do his chores and the work around the farm, and he'd take Glenn out and put him on the picket fence around the farmhouse, and Glenn would take his upper body strength and he'd pull himself around that fence and around the house he'd go as many times as he could and still maintain his strength. He was doing what we would call today physical therapy. He was trying to get the muscles in his legs, the tendons, the nerves to start working again, and he'd drag himself around that fence time after time trying to accomplish that. At age 22, Glenn Cunningham could still not walk. He could shuffle along with the aid of a couple of canes that he could hold on to, but at age 25, Glenn Cunningham broke the world record in the mile run. He had set for himself a goal of excellence. He ran the mile in 4 minutes and 6 seconds. Now, that's a pretty good mile by even today's standards, and anyone that knows about that will realize that. How did he accomplish that? He wasn't even supposed to live. He wasn't supposed to ever be able to walk again. He set for himself a goal of excellence. He was determined to do something. Just like we set for ourselves a goal of excellence to obtain eternal life, we can, but we have to have a goal first. We can't just meander through life hoping for the best. We have to set a goal that is worthy and then work toward that goal. Remember what Paul said, "This one thing I do." One thing. Paul said, "I'm going to heaven. I'm going to live a Christian life, and nobody's going to keep me from gaining that eternal crown." And Paul said, not only have I accomplished that, but you can too, but you have to be a goal setter to do it. Spiritually speaking, we should ask ourselves, what kind of goals have we set? And how determined are we to meet those goals? It takes determination, doesn't it? Sometimes it just takes plain old guts. We just have to go out there and work through the difficulties of life, and we never know what life's going to bring. We set a goal, and life throws us a curve down the road, and we have to make some changes, but we can still attain our goals if we seek to do that with all of our being. In Genesis chapter 12 and in verse 5, it is said of Sarah and Abraham, "And they set forth to go into the land of Canaan, and into the land of Canaan they came." I think that's a wonderful passage. Abraham and his wife determined to go into the land of Canaan, and what happened? And into the land of Canaan they came. They set a goal, didn't they? We're going somewhere. We need to set a goal for our spiritual Canaan land, that is to go to heaven. And if we do that and we stick with that goal, one day we will see heaven and we'll be able to live there with our Savior forever. The second biblical principle of success that I want to mention tonight is that we must be willing to put first things first. Put first things first. Jesus said it best in Matthew 6 and 33 when he said, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." So we have to have a determination. We have to have a priority system of what's really most important in our lives. You can have the best goal in the world, but if you throw your time away doing other things of less importance, you'll never accomplish the goal that you set out to do. I know people that have had noble goals in life, but somewhere they got sidetracked and they lost sight of their goal. Sometimes people determine to live a Christian life, but somewhere along the way they get sidetracked and they get pulled away from that noble goal. We have to make Jesus first and foremost in our lives. Let's see now how this works in life, and then we'll look at the spiritual side of it. Several years ago, quite a few years ago really, it would be in the 1920s, U.S. Steel was a struggling company in our nation's economy. And if you know much about the economic world, you've heard of U.S. Steel and that it went on to become one of the great giants in our country and made millions upon millions of dollars. The president of U.S. Steel was a man by the name of Charles Schwab. Charles Schwab was having a lot of difficulty in getting his business off the ground, getting things really going. He had heard of an efficiency expert, a man by the name of Ivy Lee. So he sent for this man. Ivy Lee came over to where he was at, and he wanted his expertise, his help to get him through this. Now, his advice to Mr. Schwab was to put first things first. Now, when you're charging somebody for advice like that, you got to dress it up a little more than that. So there was a little more to it than just that. But that's basically what it boiled down to, put first things first. And Mr. Schwab said, I don't understand completely. What is it that I need to do? He said, well, every day when you come into work, take a few minutes, sit down at your desk, take a piece of paper, and make a list of what's the most important things you need to do today. And he said, put the very most important thing at the top of the list and then work down the list from there. And Mr. Schwab said, well, what if at the end of the day, I haven't even got number one accomplished? And he said, well, you can go to bed and rest that night knowing that you spent the whole day working on the number one most important thing that you needed to do. And he said, then when you get that one done, cross it off and work on number two and number three and so on down the line until you get accomplished what you need to do. Now, how would you go about charging for advice like that? Well, Mr. Schwab was concerned about what this was going to cost him, and so he's asking Ivy Lee, how much do I owe you? Ivy Lee said, and you have to remember, this is the 1920s. Ivy Lee said, I'll tell you what. You try this for one full year, and at the end of one full year, you write me a check for what you think this advice is worth. Well, he tried it for one full year. At the end of that year, he sent him a check for $25,000. Now, evidently that advice worked out pretty good for him because he went on to be a great businessman and accomplish a great deal in this life. The spiritual aspect of putting first things first will work even better than that for you and I. Look with me in Colossians, and we'll look at chapter 3, and I'd like to read verses 1 and 2. Paul says, if ye then be risen with Christ, that is, risen up out of the watery grave of baptism, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. Isn't Paul saying put first things first? Isn't he saying when you come forth in that new life to make the Lord the most precious thing, the most important thing in your life? I believe that's exactly what he's trying to say. Now let's come over to Matthew chapter 6 and we'll look at verse 19. Jesus says, lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Jesus is basically teaching that principle of first things first. Do what is most important. What is your real treasure in life? I would ask you tonight, where's your treasure? You tell me where your treasure's at, and I'll tell you where your heart's at. Because where your heart's at, that's where your treasure's going to be. And if our treasure is in heaven, we're going to do everything we can to get to heaven to be where our treasure's at. Many people lay up only treasures here on earth, not realizing that one day they'll have to go off and leave all of that. So what we work for here, one day we'll lose. What we lay up in heaven, we can go and enjoy that. I want to give you an example of two men that I knew here in this life, both no longer living now, but who knew where their treasure was at. The first man, his name was Elmo Ellis. Both were members of the Lord's Church. I met Elmo Ellis a little over 40 years ago in Flint, Michigan. I was working with a congregation, and the first time I saw him, he came into the building and he had two canes he was walking with, and they had those metal straps that went around his wrist, you've seen them, were connected to the cane, and he was working very slowly to get himself into the building. He was probably a man of around 50 years old at that time. He had been a fighter pilot in World War II. In that, he got shot down by an enemy aircraft, and he managed to get out of his airplane, the parachute out, his canopy on his chute open. He was floating down. He said, "I was thinking it's all going to be okay. If I can evade the enemy on the ground, I'll be all right." But he said the guy that shot him down saw and turned around. And he saw him floating. He turned around and came back and strafed him with machine gun fire from the aircraft. And, of course, that damaged his legs severely. And from the time he got home from the war, of course his war was over at that time, he was crippled for the rest of his life. But yet he was a faithful Christian. In the years that I was there, he never missed a service of the church that I know of. And if you've ever been to Michigan, they can have some pretty cold weather up there. We went 30 days that it never got above zero one of the years I was there, sometimes 40 and 50 below. One year we had 50 inches of snow on the ground at one time. We had a gospel meeting the first year I was there, and the first night of the gospel meeting, we're in the building. It's 45 minutes before the meeting starts, and a snowstorm blows in. And I mean, it's snowing hard. You can't even see the parking lot, basically. And I'm beginning to wonder, is anybody going to show up tonight? I saw a car finally pull in, and I couldn't tell whose car it was, but finally I see Brother Ellis making his way across the parking lot. Here was a man that knew where his treasure was at. When he got in, as slow as he had to walk, he was covered in snow, but he came in, and in all the time I knew him, I never heard him complain. I never heard him moan about anything. He just knew where his treasure was. He knew what was most important in his life. He wanted to go to heaven, and what a wonderful example he set for everybody else. You know, I don't know that anybody would have held anything against him had he stayed home that night with his condition, but he never took that for a reason. He said, "I'm going to be there. I can do it. Takes me a little longer to get in than it does other people, but I can get there." And as far as I know, he lived a faithful life until the time that he died. I want to mention one other man that has been dead for a few years. I baptized him and his wife. Mike Thomason was his name. Mike was a Vietnam veteran. And in Vietnam, we've all heard of Agent Orange, and some maybe even here have been exposed to that. Mike said, "I was part of the ones distributing that." He didn't fly the aircraft, but he helped load the aircraft with the Agent Orange. He said at the time we had no idea what the dangers were with it, but he would suffer from it all of his life. And he had terrible problems breathing. He had all sorts of health problems. And when I met him and baptized him, he was on oxygen. He would have a difficult time getting in the building. We took the oxygen off just before we put him under the water and put it back on as soon as we got him up. And yet he never missed a service. He was always there. Sometimes he'd have to stop and rest three or four times from the parking lot till he got into his pew to regain his breath. He couldn't hardly breathe, but he was still always there. I remember on one occasion his wife was trying to get him to go to the emergency room. It was a Wednesday night. And he said, "No, I'm going to church." She said, "Mike, you can't go to church. You've got to go to the emergency room." He said, "I'm going to church if it kills me." And that's where he went. He came to the services. He made it all the way through. And then he went to the emergency room. They put him in the hospital that night. Now, did he go above and beyond? I'd say he probably did. But he knew where his treasure was at, didn't he? He knew that he didn't have a whole lot of life left in him. And he wanted to serve his Lord the best he could in the time that he had left. And he made every effort to do exactly that. Put first things first. That means to make Christ and his church that he died for the most important thing in your life. Biblical principle of success number 3. Whatever you do, do it enthusiastically. You know, being enthusiastic is contagious, isn't it? And when we're being enthusiastic, other people around us can catch on to that. And it's good to see people with enthusiasm. And they come to the church building, and it's kind of contagious for us. In Ecclesiastes 9 and 10, we're told, "Whatsoever thy hand findeth to do, do it with all thy might." Be enthusiastic. Put everything you've got into it. Don't be ho-hum. Don't be so-so. Put everything you've got into doing it. You know, we like to watch football or any sport that we particularly are interested in, but we like people that put everything they've got into it. Sometimes they talk about a running back that when he runs the ball, he puts everything he has into it. Every coach is looking for players like that. And that's the kind of servant we need to be. In Colossians 3 and 23, Paul said, "And whatsoever ye do it heartily, as unto the Lord and not unto men." Put your heart into it. If you're going to live a Christian life, put everything you've got into it. Be enthusiastic about doing that. Look with me in Revelation chapter 3. We find God's attitude toward the opposite view of enthusiasm. And here in Revelation 3 and verse 14, we have the church at Laodicea. I know everyone in here is familiar with this. "And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write these things, saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth." So we see the attitude of Christ. What does he want from you and I? He wants us to be zealous. He wants us to be on fire in our service to him. Not cold, not lukewarm. Lukewarm, there's not much we care about lukewarm, is there? You know, if you like coffee, usually you like it hot, don't you? I've known a few people that like ice cold coffee, but if that's the case, you want it cold. But lukewarm, what does the waitress come by or the waiter says, "Can I warm up your coffee? Can I heat it up for you?" Why? It's gotten lukewarm. You know, if I'm drinking milk, I don't want lukewarm milk. I like it ice cold. So we can see a difference here. And when it comes to Christianity, God is looking for people that are zealous, people that are on fire for him when it comes to their service. In Acts the 8th chapter, you will remember that Philip ran to join himself to the chariot. He wasn't just, you know, slowly walking over to get to the eunuch. He couldn't wait to get there and tell him about Jesus Christ. He had a message that was worthy, and he was urgent to get there. My father gave me some pretty good advice when I was a boy. He said, "Son, whatever is worth doing well. If you're going to do something, do the best that you can at it. Don't half do it. Don't just make an attempt at it. If you're going to do it, give it the best that you've got." And that's true in every area of life. whether it's in employment or whether we're playing a game, and certainly true in Christian living, to give it the very best that we have to give. If it's worth doing at all, it's worth doing right. Someone has said there's nothing in life as messy as a half-lived Christian life. Now really, there's no such thing as a half-lived Christian life. You either live for Christ or you don't live for Christ. You're either in for everything or you're not in for anything. And so we want to make the Lord first in our lives. If you're going to be a Christian, you need to go all the way. Give it everything you've got. Do the very best that you can. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Our fourth biblical principle of success tonight, and then some. I mentioned that in a couple of sermons ago, and I said I'd talk more about it tonight. This is a principle that I believe is extremely important in life, and that is, and then some. I want to tell you about a young millionaire, a multimillionaire, that a few years back in the state of Florida retired. He was so young that it was really a big deal. That he was a multimillionaire, that wasn't so big, but he became one at such an early age that he was retiring at about the age of 30 years, I believe. And of course, this drew a big crowd of reporters. He was announcing his retirement and everybody wanting to know, how did he do this? How's he able to become so wealthy and retire so early in life? Well, this young millionaire told them when they asked him how he had accomplished this, he said three little words, and then some, and then some. That made the difference in his life. Well, Jesus gave this principle first. And if we turn over to Matthew chapter 5 and the Sermon on the Mount, we'll see this principle being given. Matthew chapter 5, we'll look at verses 40 and 41. And if any man will sue thee at the law and take away thy coat, let him have thy cloak also. Isn't he saying, give him and then some? And whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him twain. Isn't he saying, go with him and then some? That's a biblical principle, isn't it? We can see it applied by Jesus, and it's something that we can help to make us successful in physical life, but certainly in our spiritual service to God. That's the whole principle of Christianity. Full measure, heaped up, shaken down. That's it, isn't it? Pressed together, doing everything we can to serve the God of heaven to the very best of our ability. Not how little can I do, not how little can I give and still get to heaven, not how little can I attend and still get to heaven, but how much can I do and then some. Do everything that God expects of us and then do a little bit extra. You know, we can always be that person that says, I could do a little bit more. I'm willing to do a little bit more. It makes all the difference in the world. When the reporters asked him how these three little words made him a millionaire, he said, well, as a student in school, I always did what the teachers assigned me, and then some. He said, when I got a job and I started working, I always did what the boss told me to do, and then some. He said, I'd do a little bit extra. And he said, when I got into business for myself, I always gave people what they had a right to expect, and then some. That's one of the good measures of a good business person, isn't it? To give people what they have coming and then give them a little extra. You know, it's kind of like the baker's dozen on those donuts. You get that little extra. And it doesn't matter what the business is. It doesn't matter what company it is. If people get a little extra treatment, that's going to make all the difference in the world. And we need to understand that. I want to give you one last story here that makes this point. A story about one of the great surgeons of our country, and I'm sorry I don't remember his name. He was from Boston. This goes back a few years, but he was a renowned surgeon. People would come from all over the United States and all over the world to watch this man do surgery. And there was a young man, a doctor, that came from somewhere in the United States, took his vacation, went to Boston. This man operated in a big hospital. They had a big observatory where people could sit and watch this surgeon do the operation. And he spent his whole week of vacation sitting there watching surgery after surgery, this great surgeon operating. And finally, on the last day of his vacation and the last surgery, the doctor had had a rather lengthy surgery. He was closing up the wound, and after he finished, he was tired. He went down the corridor and went into the room where he could clean up and change clothes and get ready to go home. This young doctor made his way down and around the corridor and knocked on the door of the dressing room. And the fellow said, "Come in." And he said, "Sir," told him who he was. He said, "I've been watching you operate." And he said, "You do something that really bugs me." And he said, "If I don't ask you about it," he said, "it's going to bug me the rest of my life." He said, "Can I ask you a question?" The old man said, "Yes, go ahead." He said, "Is it not true that our textbooks and our doctors that teach us in the schools of medicine tell us that one stitch tied properly, one knot is all that we need to tie when we're stitching someone up?" And he said, "Yes, that's true. That's what the books say. That's what the doctors, the professors teach." And he said, "Well, I've noticed that when you stitch somebody up, you tie three knots." He said, "Could you tell me why you tie three knots?" He said, the old man leaned over against the table and said, "I can tell you why." He said, "After I've done a surgery," he said, "about 2 o'clock in the morning," he said, "I'll sit up in bed and I'll go over every bit of that surgery in my mind." And he said, "I'm being concerned, did I do everything right? Did I get this person stitched up properly?" And he said, "I'll remember the textbooks teach that one knot in a suture is all that's necessary, but I'll remember I didn't tie one knot, I tied two. And I didn't tie two knots, I tied three." And then he said, "I'll be able to lay back down and be comforted and go right back to sleep knowing that I've done my job and then some." Wouldn't it be wonderful if we all had a surgeon that had that attitude to do a little bit extra and then some? It applies in every job, doesn't it? Whatever it is in life, if somebody hires you to do a job, do what's expected of you and then some. In Christianity, do everything that God wants us to do and then see if we can do a little bit extra, have some then some to add to that and do the very best that we possibly can. That brings us to our last and final step, and it's a dirty four-letter word, so I'm not even going to say it. I'm just going to spell it for you. W-O-R-K. Work. That's what we got to do, isn't it? And you know, not many people are willing to do that. A lot of people don't like that word. They think, work? Somebody wants me to work? Somebody wants me to do something? Can't I just sit in a pew and go to heaven? No, the Lord says there's work to be done. There was for all the New Testament Christians of the first century, and there still is today. Not a lot of people like this word, but God obviously did, because he used it some 619 times. So I know work is a good thing. It's something that we need to do. We're all better off physically when we work, aren't we? And we're better off spiritually when we work. Can we work too much? Not for the Lord. I don't believe we can. And so we need to apply this principle of success. In John 9 and verse 4, Jesus said, "I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can work." There's a time when the opportunity to work runs out. Have you ever been working and daylight's fading? And maybe you didn't have lights to keep on working after it was dark, and you're starting to hurry now. You're trying to get as much done as you can. We understand that principle in the first century, that the night would come when no man can work. And certainly spiritually, the night comes, or the time comes, when we can't work anymore. All the work we'll ever do for the Lord must be done while we live in this physical body. When this life is over, then we rest. Rest doesn't come now. Rest is for later. Now is the time to work. Paul said in Titus 2 and 14, that are we are to be people zealous of good works. We are to look for things to do, to be active in trying to work for the Lord and be all that we can be. In 1 Corinthians 15 and 58, Paul said, "Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord." We need to work for the Lord. We need to be steadfast and unmovable about it. We're going to work, as the song says, till Jesus comes. In Galatians 6 and verse 9, Paul said, "And let us not be weary in well-doing." Not weary. You know, sometimes it's easy to grow weary, isn't it, to get tired. And sometimes in the physical sense, we get tired also. But he says, "For in due season we shall reap if we faint not." Keep on working. It'll be worth it in the end. Work all you can, as long as you can, while you can, because the time will come when our work here will be over. When it comes to Christianity, what kind of worker are you? What kind of worker am I? Am I a worker that is pleasing to the God of heaven? One that God could point to and say, have you noticed my servant over here? And call your name and say, look how good he or she works in the kingdom and how pleased he would be because of that. I want to conclude our lesson tonight by looking at the greatest and the grandest of all goals, the salvation of the human soul. We are concerned about souls, are we not? That is our great desire in life, to reach as many as we can, as long as we can. I would say to you tonight, anyone can go to heaven that wants to go there more than they want anything else in this life. And no one can go to heaven that wants anything else more than they want to go to heaven. You know, there's a lot of people in our world that would love to go to heaven, but they don't want to go there enough to make the sacrifices that you're willing to make in life. We'll have to make those sacrifices to one day live with our Savior. You've got to desire it more than you want anything else in life. Coming back to the text of our lesson in Philippians 3 and 13, remember Paul said, "This one thing I do." Paul was single-minded. One thing. Did Paul do other things? Absolutely. But he was single-minded when it came to serving the Lord. "This one thing I do. I'm going to go to heaven. I'm going to live that faithful life." Let's review very quickly. First goal, set for yourself a goal of excellence. We need to do that, don't we? Have that goal of excellence in our mind. Put first things first in our lives. Whatever you do, do it enthusiastically. Put everything you've got into it, and then some. Be willing to go that extra mile. Be willing to do a little bit more than maybe you've even been required to do. That's something God appreciates. And then be willing to work. I don't know when the end of the world is coming, but I know when it's coming for me. The day my heart beats the last time, that will be the end of the world for me. The day you gasp your last breath of air, that will be the end of the world for you. And so we need to remember that and keep that in mind and understand that as you live, so shall you die. And as you die, so shall you face God in the judgment. And as you face God in the judgment, so shall you be throughout all eternity. It's up to you and I, really, isn't it? The goals we set in life and what we determine to do. There's really no reason to sit around and wring our hands and wonder, am I going to be saved or not? If we live right, we'll die right, we'll stand before God right, we'll be right throughout all eternity. Live wrong, die wrong, stand before God wrong, wrong throughout all eternity. It's really that simple. I know that's kind of blunt, but that's the way the Bible is, isn't it? It just gives us the plain facts of what we need to do. I know that you love the Lord and you want to make Him first in your life. And as we close this gospel meeting tonight, I want to ask if you're a Christian. I would suppose everybody in here tonight, as best I can recognize, have obeyed the gospel of Christ. Perhaps you're a child of God, and maybe there's some sin that separates you from the God of heaven. If so, you can repent of that. God's second law of pardon in 1 John 1:9 has given us the opportunity to do that. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If you're here tonight and you're subject to heaven's invitation in any way, would you come as we stand and sing?